Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome. It's now time for the featured bout of the evening. From the four corners of the world, to the four corners of this ring, the fight starts now!
Well, a very warm welcome from a bright, sunny London. We haven't said that much recently, have we? We are in the shadow of the famous Wembley Arch at the Box Park in the west of the city. There it is. What a day. This afternoon, the official weigh-in for a big transatlantic clash between two of the top contenders in the 168-pound division. Former middleweight world champion New York's Danny Jacobs and former world title challenger at super middleweight John Ryder. And Darren, could this be either man's last opportunity to make their way back towards world title contention?
Yeah, I think so, Chris. I know Daniel Jacobs said he doesn't believe so, but I just feel if he loses to John Ryder, where does he go? Yeah. Who does he fight? I think he just achieved so much, had such a distinguished career already, winning titles and coming back from that horrific health scare that he had. Yeah. I mean, what a great career he's had. So I think it's a struggle. John Ryder's done so well to get where he's at, should already be crowned a world champion. Will he want to rebuild again? I don't think so. So much on the line. There is an awful lot of pressure. We asked John, didn't we, if the pressure will play a part, and he said no. If anything, it gives me that little bit extra. So I just, with everything that's on the line, I expect it to be a very good fight.
And an historic venue in Alexandra Palace too. All questions will be answered rather tomorrow night live on The Zone. Daniel Jacobs and John Ryder.
Daniel Jacobs, the Miracle Man. 37 wins, 3 losses. From Brownsville, Brooklyn, New York.
John the Gorilla Ryder, 30 wins, 17 KOs, 5 losses. From Islington, London, England.
Just get him over here, show him what London's about.
I want to be a Hall of Fame fighter. I want to be known as one of the best of my generation. And I still have an opportunity to prove that.
I still believe that there's chapters to be written in my career. And I need to show my family, my friends, my partner that all the sacrifice wasn't wasted. It was all worth it.
Representing Brooklyn, New York, and into the ring, there is still much to accomplish in his career.
John Ryder, the Londoner, wants another shot at the world title.
For the both of us, this is a fight that needs to happen for us to go on and continue the legacy that we want to set out for ourselves.
February 12th.
Wow, this is what it's all about.
I'm confident that I can beat him.
I want to become the best version of myself again. I'm ready for that.
Plenty at stake for both fighters tomorrow night live on The Zone. 7 fights on the undercard as well. Let's get the fighters weighed in. We'll hand you over without further ado. To our MC for this afternoon, it's Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, live from the Box Park here in Wembley, we welcome you to the official weigh-in of Jacobs versus Ryder. It's all going down tomorrow night, the WBA Super Middleweight Eliminator at Alexandra Palace here in London. It's all brought to you by Eddie Hearn for Matchroom Boxing with our sponsors Betfred, Well Hydrate, and JDSports.com. We'll start now with our first fight. This is scheduled for 5:15 tomorrow, featuring 6 rounds of super welterweight action from Russia, Alexei Tukhtarov. And his opponent from London, England, undefeated, Sugar Shy, Shaibo De Freitas. First on the scale, Alexei Tukhtarov. $143.4 for the Russian. His opponent, London's own, Shiloh De Freitas. $143.6 for the young, undefeated super welterweight. $143.6 Again, this fight will kick off at 5:15 tomorrow sharp at Alexandra Palace. Ali Pally, the host of tomorrow night's big fights. Brought to you by Matchroom Boxing and Eddie Hearn. Thank you, gentlemen. We will see you tomorrow. And by the way, still our sound tickets available. If you don't have yours yet, be sure to grab them before the action kicks off tomorrow. And again, you can get the app. It's DAZN. Log on to DAZN.com.
Yeah, Charlotte De Freitas, very, very exciting welterweight prospect. I was talking to Joe Cordina about him. He's done a lot of round sparring with him. And I said, what do you think? And he said, absolutely fantastic. Because he's got a little bit of everything. Speaking to a couple of the fighters in Adam Bushim, where he was a couple of weeks ago for his first two fights. They both said he sparred brilliantly against Mick Conlon and some of the fighters there. And I'm just getting a bit of crossover with our MC here. So I think our next fighters are up on the stage. I thought he was going to wait for us, but he's not. So we're heading over to our next fight. But yeah, Charlotte De Freitas really is one to watch.
Opponent, another undefeated fighter from the UK, Cyrus Pennison. For Von Zem, he is in his 31st professional fight tomorrow. From Staryosko, Russia, first on the scale, Yevgeny Vatsam. Vatsam. Next up from Ashington, 2-0 with one knockout, here is Cyrus Pennington. For Pennington. Both fighters are good. Tomorrow night, the Russian squares off Yevgeny Vatsam against the UK's own undefeated Cyrus Pennington. Fight number 2 on tomorrow's card from the Ali Pally, London.
Definitely worth watching in preparation for this is Yevgeny Vatsam against Darren Tetley, another very skilled southpaw they met last year. And Vatsam is pretty solid, good fundamentals, but Darren Tetley had the better of him and getting around the outside of him, working off the southpaw jab, stepping around him and landing the hook off the back. Kind of Cyrus Pattinson's bread and butter, really. But nonetheless, this fits the bill at Cyrus Pattinson's direction not to be given easy fights at this stage of his career, and there shouldn't be one.
No, I don't think it will be, but I've been so impressed with Cyrus. I know what he's done as an amateur, an extremely talented fighter, has bundles of experience in the amateurs which are holding him in good stead as a pro. He just wants to get busy now. He wants to have as many fights as he can. I'm pretty sure he'd like to be fighting for some sort of title at the end of the year even. Really good fight. I'm looking forward to seeing him in action again. Like I said, the most important thing for Cyrus now is just to remain busy.
And by the way, these first two fights and the one you'll just see weighing in a couple of moments' time are all going to be live on Before the Bell, which is the pre-broadcast segment on The Zone. And it'll be on Match and Boxing's YouTube channel from about 5:15 local time. Darren and I will be at the commentary desk calling those fights before it all starts at 7 o'clock. So Cyrus Pattinson and Charlotte De Freitas in action, as well as the young man you're about to see weighing, Hopi Price. So without further ado, let's hand you back to Joe Martinez.
And I will keep this weigh-in going, ladies and gentlemen. Six rounds, super bantamweight action. First up, from Mexico, making his way to the stage, Ricardo Román. His opponent from Leeds, undefeated Hopi Price. Thank you. First to step onto the scale, hailing from Durango, Mexico, 14-12 with 5 knockouts. Here is Ricardo Bam Bam Roman. .124 His opponent from lead 6-0 with 2 knockouts. Here is Humping Prize. .125 for Humping Price. .125. This will be our final preliminary fight before going live on the zone at the Ali Pali.
Yeah, Hopi Price, very, very impressive. Last time out in Leeds, it was a fight that really was kind of billed as a 50-50 against a former area champion, and he took him apart in under 2 rounds in pretty emphatic style. We didn't even see the punch land that he threw. And I know Dave Caldwell now is in that kind of hinterland between wanting to push him on and up, but also wanting to let him physically mature, which he now feels he has done.
Well, I tell you what, it's so exciting because we know how much talent that Hopi Price has, but with that physical maturity that's starting to come and is still more to come, he's going to be a real handful.
Yeah.
He's really starting to hurt his opponents. He's spiteful. You wouldn't think he's talking to him, but when the bell goes, he really wants to hurt his opponent. And I think, yeah, with that extra bit of physical maturity, he's going to be a real, real handful. You see the size of him. He towers over all of his opponents. And we said it the other day, who knows what weight he could end up at?
Yeah, very, very young man, still developing, but lots to like about Hopi Price, looking to go 7-0 tomorrow night in our last pre-broadcast segment against Ricardo Bam Bam Roman from Mexico. He really comes to let the hands go. And Dave Caldwell is seeing this as somewhat of a tune-up before what they hope will be a higher-profile fight next month. So we'll wait and see how it all pans out for Hopi tomorrow night before all of the action kicks off live on the Zone. Saturday night, tomorrow night at Alexandra Palace. So let's send you back over to Joe Martinez for the first of the televised fights.
And all fans, we'll move on to our main card tomorrow night. This kicks off on the Zone. You can catch the action live with 8 rounds of middleweight action featured by Javier Maciel. First up on the stage from Argentina. And his opponent from Houston, Texas, Austin Williams. La Bestia, Javier Francisco Maciel from Don Torcuato, Buenos Aires, Argentina. First on the scale, 33-15 with 23 knockouts. Official weight, 167.5. And from Houston, Texas, USA, 9-0 with 7 knockouts. Here's the undefeated middleweight, Austin Ammo Williams. .161 Williams. Again, this will be our first fight live on the Zone tomorrow night from Ali Pali. Undefeated Austin Williams of Houston, Texas, USA, takes on the Argentinian Javier Francisco Maciel. A loaded card tomorrow night, brought to you by Eddie Hearn from Matchroom Boxing. From Alexandra Palace, live on the Zone. Thank you. Well, fighters, we will see you tomorrow night to kick things off for us.
Big physical fighter, Maciel, seen better days at 37 years of age, but you'll know he's better than those past nine defeats on his record. Still a handful, as you saw against Kevin Lillie-Sadjo. Austin Williams, Darren, your old weight division, does he have world-level potential, do you think?
Absolutely. Bundles of talent. It's all about his headspace, had some mental battle, got over them now. With the talent that he has and now being in the right place of mind, I think he can go all the way. Yeah.
Another hugely talented fighter who could well go all the way is Ellie Scotney against one woman who did go all the way at Super Flyweight, Jorgelina Guarini. The two of them meet at 122 pounds tomorrow night. Let's hand you back over for the weigh-in.
Next up, 10 rounds of action for the WBA Intercontinental Bantamweight Championship. First up, from Nicoya, Argentina, Jorgelina Guarini. From Catford, London, undefeated Ellie Scotney. First on the scale, 9-3-2 with one knockout, Jorgelina Guarini from Argentina. /119.6. Next up, the undefeated Catford native of London, Ellie Scotney. /121.2 for Scotney. Women's WBA Intercontinental Bantamweight Championship up for grabs tomorrow night. There is the belt on stage right now. As these two bantamweights will go after it, Argentina's Jorgelina Jota Guarini and Catford, London's undefeated Ellie Scotney.
Shaquille O'Neal might want those trainers back at some point.
You're jealous of them.
I am. I'd like to have those. I might see if I can pinch them off her. Really good fight this. We know Guarini is her best at 115 and has not been her best between 126 and 130. But looking at there's no real height or reach discrepancy between these two. And she's got a lot more experience. Very good fighter. This could be a hell of a scrap.
I said that to you then, didn't I? I think it's going to be a good scrap. I think Guarini's going to come to the centre ring and let her hands go. If that's the case, we know what Ellie Scotney's like. Likes to get stuck in. So, yeah, expect fireworks.
Looking forward to the return of Felix Cash as well tomorrow night. He's been out for a year after a sublime performance to win the British title against Denzel Bentley, but he's in a tough scrap as well live on the zone. Let's hand you over now to the weigh-in.
And now we move closer to our main event, ladies and gentlemen. This next fight, 12 rounds from the WBC International Middleweight Championship. First up on the stage from Makhachkala, Russia, Magomed Madiev. And his opponent, 14-0 with 10 knockout wins from Workingham, Berkshire, UK, undefeated, Felix Cash. to the scale. He is 15-0. Four knockout wins. The undefeated Russian, Magomed Maniyev. .159, Maniyev. And his foe, Taranet, also undefeated at 14-0, 10 KOs, the UK's Felix Cash. .159.6.
Of a skin to pinch on Felix Cash as usual. Been out for a year, and we know how skillful Maniyev is, Darren. And if there is any ring rust to Cash, as good a condition as he's in, could be certainly a very tricky first half of the fight.
Yeah, definitely. I was just saying to you there, Maniyev, he's a bit of a handful. He's a good fighter, and he's got a strange sort of rhythm that he gets into really early. Quite busy, moves his head quite well side to side. And you rightly so said there, he needs to be taken out of that rhythm. Felix Cash has got to be busy, he's got to hold the centre in, get behind the jab, be spiteful. And look, that's what naturally Felix Cash does anyway. So I expect this, like you say, to be very exciting for a few rounds. I think after the midway point, we'll see Felix Cash really take over.
The International Middleweight Championship on the line tomorrow night. Two undefeated fighters putting their perfect record on the line for the strap. Russia's Magomed Maniyev, 15-0 with four knockouts, and the UK's Felix Cash, at 14-0 with 10 big knockout wins.
Yeah, Maniyev, very slick, very fast, sharp, in and out, good head movement. Likes to use the full width of the ring, and even though the style that Felix Cash likes to employ, and I guess his initiative in the early goings will be to try and frustrate him. Very, very good fight this, especially for a comeback for Felix Cash, if he's going to get in the mix towards the end of this year with some of the top contenders at £160. And another man who has got his ambition set very high, certainly in terms of ticket sales anyway, is Johnny Fisher. For a six-round heavyweight, 2,500 sold, Eddie Hearn believes that may be a world record in boxing.
Incredible.
The great work his dad's done, shifting all of those from his front room as well. We'll be speaking to him live on the broadcast tomorrow night too. But Johnny Fisher has been fantastically exciting and also impressed a lot under the guidance of Mark Tibbs, hasn't he?
Yeah, definitely. And that's the sort of coach he needs, someone who's going to teach him the fundamental basics. You think he starts fast in his previous fights. With 2,500 people behind him at Ali Pali with those acoustics, it's going to be fireworks. Yeah. He's going to go straight to centre ring and let his hands go. So expect a fast start from Johnny Fisher.
Well, his opponent, big Spaniard Gabriel Nguema, about 6'6" tall, did 10 rounds with Oscar Rivas not too long ago. Can he provide some much-needed resistance for Johnny Fisher? They're going to go head-to-head in just a couple of moments' time. Let's hand you back over to RMC.
And now, fight fans, here we go. Six rounds, heavyweight action. First up on the stage from Spain, Gabriel Nguema. And his opponent, 4-0 with four knockouts from Romford Essex. Ladies and gentlemen, the undefeated Romford Bull, Johnny Fisher. Gabriel Nguema first on the scale, 22nd professional fight from the capital of Madrid, Spain. .231.7 Nguema. And now here's the Romford Bull, Johnny Fisher. Yeah. 237 for the Bull. 237. Again, it's now scheduled for 6 rounds in the heavyweight division. The Spaniard Gabriel Nguema looking to upset undefeated KO artist, the Romford Bull, Johnny Fisher. Special attraction tomorrow night in the heavyweight division, live on the zone from the Ali Pali, London.
Nguema, big, solid opponent, looking to provide some resistance for Johnny Fisher on Saturday night. And Johnny Fisher said, well, I'm going to try a more patient approach and set my work up. But you think that it's going to be difficult with that many tickets sold?
Yeah, I just think he's going to want to play up to the crowd. He's a young novice. He's sold an awful lot of tickets. This is the natural thing to do. I'm sure another beauty of having Mark Sibbs in the corner is when he gets back after that first round, if he does go hell for leather, it will just settle him down and say, look, calm down, get back to your boxing, get behind your jab. I can't wait to hear the noise of the Ali Pali when he makes his ring walk.
Yeah, Nguema's got 10 wins, 11 defeats, 4 knockouts. He did go 8 with Kem Lundqvist, who I commentated on, actually, the Saulen show in some far corner of Germany about 3 years ago. He's okay, but I think, as you say, once he feels the power and the blunt force of Johnny Fisher, it's going to be very hard to keep him off, isn't it?
Nguema, what he does is he leans back an awful lot, so it's important for Johnny to bring his feet in and try and land that right hand. He will get over-eager, but I think as the rounds go on, if it does go round, you get Mark Tibb in his ear, and I think it'll be a very good finish in the end by Johnny Fisher.
Well, he's finished 4 people in just 8 rounds, Johnny Fisher, so we'll see how long, if at all, Gabriel Nguema lasts, or maybe he'll call the upset where he had plenty last year, so don't write anybody off at this stage. There's a lot of pressure for Johnny Fisher. Going to be a fabulous night tomorrow night. 7 fights on the undercard. That is them done and dusted with our chief support as well. We now move on to our main event. I'm just waiting for word in my ear as to whether we're going to bring the fighters up yet, and I think we are. So they're ready to go to the top 168-pound contenders in a transatlantic clash in North London tomorrow night, live on The Zone. New York's Danny Jacobs and London's own John Ryder. Let's hand you back over to Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have arrived to our main event tomorrow night, live around the world on DAZN from the Ali Pali here in London, UK. It's all brought to you by Eddie Hearn for Matchroom Boxing, sponsored by Betfred, WOW Hydrate, and JD Sports. 12 rounds of action this scheduled for the WBA Super Middleweight Title Eliminator. First to step up on the stage, from Islington in London, the former WBA interim super middleweight world champion, here is John the Gorilla Ryder! And his opponent tomorrow night, 40 professional fights, 37 wins, 3 defeats, 30 wins coming by way of knockout, the former two-time middleweight champion of the world from Brooklyn, New York, Daniel the Miracle Man Jacobs! Professional fights, 17 knockouts and 30 wins. From Islington, London, John the Gorilla Ryder! .167 for Ryder, .167. His opponent ready to go, 40 professional fights, again 37 wins with 30 knockouts. hailing from Brooklyn, New York, two-time middleweight world champion, Daniel the Miracle Man Jacobs! .166 Jacobs! February 12th, live on DAZN, WBA Super Middleweight Title Eliminator. Your main event tomorrow night, John the Gorilla Ryder. London's own, he puts it on the line tomorrow against the American from Brooklyn, New York, Daniel Jacobs. The action is live on DAZN around the world from the Ali Pali of London, UK, brought to you by Eddie Hearn from Matchroom Boxing. And a thanks again to our sponsors, Betfred, Wild Hydrate, and JDSports.com. Let's hear it all. Come on, Box Park. Make some noise out there.
Two very nice, respectful guys outside of the ring. You know there's going to be plenty of fire when things start tomorrow, but some respectful words exchanged there. John Ryder knows how much Danny Jacobs has achieved over this last 10 years. He knows how well he has fared against two of the best fighters, well, in the last 15 years at middleweight, certainly. Do you want to grab Eddie a mic, Darren, just under there?
But of course, always unprompted, to be fair.
Always welcome.
It's
as
a
well.
Great thing about when you're running the event. You just thought, you know what? I'll go and talk to them two on TV.
We're just saying that nobody really has performed better outside of the pair of them fighting than Danny Jacobs against Golovkin and Canelo over these last 10 years. It's a little bit naive to write him off just because of one slightly flat performance against Gabriel Rosado, who's stylistically very different to John Ryder.
Well, the performance is what's probably giving John Ryder hope, because on paper, coming off the back of the Canelo Alvarez performance, you'd say he was a level above John Ryder. Yeah. But maybe after the Chavez fight and maybe after the Rosado fight, he might be on the slide. If he is, John's got a fantastic chance in the fight. It was really interesting, the head-to-head. He said, you saw John sort of, you know, giving him a stare, and Ryder said, Jacob said, I'm ready. He said, please don't take me lightly. Please bring your best. That's what John Ryder said.
Wow.
And he went, I wouldn't be coming to your backyard if I wasn't. And it was nice. I think, listen, both of them realise how important this fight is. I think one of the fascinating things with this fight is that Daniel Jacobs is a guy who's kind of been used to having things, not his own way, but, you know, he's been fighting at Barclays Centre in Brooklyn, MSG. And when he got the call to come to Ali Pali, I don't think he was flattered, you know? But I think he felt like he needed to prove a point after the Rosado fight. So I think he's got a little bit of a bit between his teeth coming here, and I think you'll get a better performance from him, a different kind of performance. I don't think he's going to try and box and move. I think he thinks he's a level above Ryder, and I think he thinks he can stand in there with him at times and trade, and that'll make it exciting, because that's where John's got to be in the fight.
Obviously, we spoke about what will happen if whoever loses. It's going to be tough to come back. For the winner, where do you think they go?
Well, I think, obviously, we see what Canelo Alvarez does at 168, but at the same time, you've got David Morrell, who's the regular champion. By the way, he's also a brilliant fighter, And I think the winner's could end up fighting Morrell for the Super Championship. But I think you know John well enough to know he's put all the pressure on himself in this camp to say this is it. And I think if he loses this fight, I think John Ryder would probably walk away.
What about Jacobs, though, saying if he was to lose...
Yeah, I don't know why he said that. I mean, strange. Is that trying to take a little bit of pressure? Is that sort of saying, no, you know, my legacy lives on? It was a strange comment, but I don't see a future for Danny Jacobs if he loses this fight, unless he wants to fight at a lower level, which, why would you do that when you're a two-time world champion? He's made a fortune.
Yeah,
he's a two-time world champion. But this is the reason why I think you'll get a good Danny Jacobs in this fight, because it's not like this is the opportunity of a lifetime for him. It's not like financially this is going to change his life. He just fancied it. He went, do you know what, I'll go to London and I'll fight over there. It's something different, and it might bring something different out in me. And I think that's why it could be difficult for John. But I do feel like John will give a career-best performance in there on Saturday
He'll
night.
Need to.
He will need to. Yeah. He definitely will need to.
Speaking of something different, the venue is a place that we haven't been to since we've been doing these shows. I know you went there about 10 years ago, something like that, maybe 12 years ago the last time. What made you go back to Alexandra Palace?
It's just a great venue. I mean, it's, you know, it's historic, but it looks beautiful. It's different. You know, we spend our schedule, don't we, in O2, Manchester Arena, yeah. Liverpool Arena, which are all fantastic arenas. This is something very different. The pain with this arena is really you have to build it yourself. There's no seats in there. It's just a shell. So you have to bring everything in. Costs an absolute fortune. I know there's a lot of people out there feeling sorry for me right now, but I'll get over it. But on a serious note, we go there for the darts for the World Championship, and it is, you box it. I mean, great, when it's full up, and we'll have 7,000 in there, it'll be full to the rafters. 2,500 Johnny Fisher fans as well. The atmosphere is going to be absolutely banging. By the way, Johnny Fisher's in a tough fight.
Yeah.
That's no walkover, that fight. That's a proper conditioned heavyweight. He went 10 rounds with Oscar Rivas. You know, and Johnny Fisher's just a four-fight novice, really, who has to walk out in the most bizarre of atmospheres for a four-fight novice.
Is it going to start to get difficult to match Johnny? You're going to have to pay a little bit over market value to opponents as he goes up because he's so dangerous. But I suppose there is a return because he's high up on bills, but yeah. Not an easy guy to match. You're not going to get people queuing up to fight.
No, I mean, when we first signed Johnny Fisher, we were saying we're going to go nice and slow. So we're talking now, you know, we looked at Mark Bennett for this fight. We've got Gabriel. But if you'd have said those names before the debut, yeah. I would have said absolutely no way.
Yeah.
That's 10 fights in. But he's, you know, he's improving. He's a smart guy, Johnny Fisher. Like, he's absorbing everything from Mark and Jimmy Tibbs. For Johnny, I just feel that the pressure comes from the other madness, which is the fans.
Like, is that an added pressure for you to sort of fast forward him a little bit?
Not really, because you don't want to get him beat when you've got a guy who's potentially the draw that he is. I mean, without question, he'd fill the O2 Arena for a British title fight.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Wow. And that's really where you want to get him to. But sometimes you see someone's career evolve. Like, you start off, you say, hey, look at Gavin McDonald, who retired recently. You know, his aim was to win an area title. Ended up winning an area title, winning an English title, winning a British title, winning a European title, challenging for a world title. And when Johnny Fisher started, I think if you would have said to him, British heavyweight title, I think he would have said, Carl, that would be an absolute dream. But the way we're seeing him progress, I think that's a very realistic possibility. It's only when you start getting there, you see how your levels might change. So I think at the moment he's progressing fantastically. He's so good, he's so humble. Like, you know, the position he's in, the opportunities he's been given, the fan base that he's got, and all he's worried about is just, look, I'm learning, I'm going to take it nice and slow, and this will be a tough fight because this guy will hang around. And, you know, but nervous energy is a massive thing in fight, especially with the heavyweights. You get three or four rounds in, and you've let the kitchen sink go, and you've been walking out. On that walkout, you know, you've got 7,000 fans going mad.
Yeah.
It can get really tough even over 6 rounds.
That's where Mark Tibb plays a massive part as well, not just on the tactical side of things, but, you know, to calm him down in between rounds. If you get your crystal ball out, at the end of the year, what's Johnny Fisher done?
Well, I want him to have 7 fights this year, so this will be...
Seven fights this year?
Yeah, so I want to keep him nice and active. Yeah, I mean, it's a lot of tickets. That's why I want to give him 7 fights. No. But, you know, I feel like he needs that ring time, learning. I want to box him all around the world. But, look, I want him to be 11-12-0, moving into, you know, he'll be at 8, moving into 10 rounds.
Possibly a title at the end of the year?
Yeah, listen, a southern area title that you'll call would be lovely, wouldn't it? Imagine the atmosphere down there. Yeah. Too small, but plenty of time, just a baby. Yeah. But, you know, I like what I see, and, you know, speaking to Fabio Wardley, you've heard Tyson Fury's comments about the sparring, they rate him, and he is a real pure novice.
Yeah, and Felix Cash obviously had a difficult year last year, but we're looking to see him back in tomorrow night, former British champion. We know the levels that he could potentially operate at, and most people are talking about him as the best potential British challenge to a world title in the next couple of years. How far away do you think he is with the setback that he had last year?
Well, look, we were on the verge of accepting the Demetrius Andrade fight, 4 or 5 months ago when Jason Quigley got it. You know, Felix had his problems, he had some family bereavements as well. It wasn't his time, and I'm glad he didn't take that fight because I think there's a lot more to come from Felix Cash. I love this fight because it's the dangers of inactivity against a very good, tough, undefeated Russian who's coming to win. And I think the only questions that haven't yet been asked of Felix Cash outside of the Cullen fight is what happens when it goes deep and it gets really tough and uncomfortable. And I think you might see that against Madiev. He looks super fit. He's a good fighter, very tough, bound to have a great chin as well. But I really rate Felix Cash. You know, I know you do, and everyone in the gym does. And Tony Sims wouldn't unleash him on someone like Madiev, coming off all that inactivity if he really didn't believe in this young man's potential. So we trust Tony to do so. It is a massive banana skin. Exciting, though.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, for us, for the viewers on the zone, great to see a real middleweight fight. And I believe Felix is a special talent.
Yeah, certainly. And Ellie Scotney, fast-tracking her way towards a world title, her first 10-rounder tomorrow as well. Borgolina Guanelli looked fabulous at 115. Not so great between 126 and 130, yeah. But interesting to hear her
really
comments
good.
Yesterday.
Yeah,
she kind of feels like she looked
totally different on the scales.
Remember when she boxed
Rachel Ball?
Yeah.
You know, I remember she cut her hair.
Yeah.
She shaved her hair off.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, someone should have given her some advice. She missed weight by about 5 or 6 pounds, and she shaved her head. I don't think that was going to make a major difference.
No.
But, and it's a rascal. Yeah. But, you know, now it's grown incredibly long over that 6 or 7 months. I don't know what happened. But also, Ellie Scotney, you know, a little bit of nerves. I felt up there. I did a terrible thing. I made a joke about her being able to make bantamweight, and she looked at me like she was going to kill me. So it was obviously a tight weight cut.
We said that, didn't we? We said, yes, she really had to work for it.
Yeah. But I think 122 pounds is her weight. She didn't have masses of notice for this fight, probably more like 5 or 6 weeks. So I think with a proper camp, 122 is fine. I'll stop the 118 jibes and super bantamweight. We've just signed Maylene Rivas, which we'll announce.
Yeah.
She's the WBA super bantamweight champion. Very good fighter.
Fighter, yep.
But I think that's the kind of fight Ellie Scotney needs to move into. But we'll get a different Juani in this fight. You know, we'll get someone with a great engine.
Yeah.
And this will be a really tough fight for Ellie Scotney.
Good stuff. Thanks very much. We've got 8 fights on the bill tomorrow night live from Alexandra Palace on the zone, starting about 5:15 on Before the Bell. Hope Price, Cyrus Patterson, and Shyla De Freitas before the action kicks off 7 p.m. live on the zone. Big transatlantic clash between two of the top 168 pounders in the world, Daniel Jacobs and John Ryder. Join us tomorrow, folks. Thanks for your company.
Daniel Jacobs, the Miracle Man. 37 wins, 3 losses. From Brownsville, Brooklyn, New York.
John the Gorilla Ryder, 30 wins, 17 KOs, 5 losses. From Islington, London, England.
Just get him over here, show him what London's about.
I want to be a Hall of Fame fighter. I want to be known as one of the best of my generation. And I still have an opportunity to prove that.
I still believe that there's chapters to be written in my career, and to show my family, my friends, my partner that all the sacrifice wasn't wasted, it was all worth it.
Representing Brooklyn, New York, dances into the ring. There is still much to accomplish in his career.
John Ryder, the London and Continental Shot of the World title.
For the both of us, this is a fight that needs to happen for us to go on and continue the legacy that we want to set out for ourselves.
February 12th.
Wow, this is what it's all about.
I'm confident that I can beat him.
I want to become the best version of myself again. I'm ready for that.